Well, we're going to spend the next 30 minutes or so on grip strategy. And by the way, I'm Ras Rasmussen. My banker in the IRS calls me Elmer. My mother calls me George. Most people in the grippy world call me Ras. I'm a life member, life master, member of the Cribbage Hall of Fame. This great organization, the American Cribbage Congress, has been an important part of my life, and you can put them on the front page. Everybody nowadays has a favorites list. It ought to include www.cribbage.org. A lot of good stuff on the website. So, we've got a couple little bits to pick up from holdovers from last week. And I'm not going to cover all of these, but remember we had hand recognition and counting. A paper that looks like this should be in front of you there somewhere on the cribbage board. And these are a few hands that I've observed over the last few weeks, months in club. And the first one, the person needed 20 points to win the game. And you notice there's a flush in there. If you keep that little double run, you can, this here will make 20. With every one of these cards. If you keep the flush and you cut any one of these four, it's 20. By keeping the double run, you only kept 10. You notice it's a 6, 6, 7, 8, 9 with a jack. So watch for these flushes. That's 12 right there. And if I match any one of these four cards, it's 20. Very important. If you hold that double run, it's 10, and you've got to cut the 7 or the 8 in order to get 20 out of it. Whereas this, cut any one of those four, it can be hearts, diamonds, spades, clubs. Just know you've got 12, and any one of these little suckers makes 20. If you notice the second one down, it shows a 7-7 and a 10-1 king. The person who had this put the pair of sevens in their crib. They took a small hand, the 7-7 with the 1 is worth 4, and a pair of tens to the crib means you start with 6. That's a big advantage to have a 2-point edge going in. So don't worry about that 7-7. Keep the 4 in the hand and put the pair of 10s in the crib. And of course, if it was your opponent, you would put the 10 king. And you still would have 4. And if you go down there a little ways, you see a hand that says 4-5-6-7-7 queen. Start with 9. If you keep that little double run in there, you've only got 8. Keep the 4-5-6 with the 10-pointer, doesn't matter what it is. 10-jack-queen-king, 4-5-6, either 10-jack-queen-king, any one of them. Put the pair of sevens in your crib, and you start with 9. And you've got a lot better discard to your crib rather than the 4-face card. See? So those things are all important. There's another one down there. I was amazed when I saw this. 2 jacks, 2 fives, and an 8 and a king. The person who discarded this just put the 5-8 in their crib because they didn't want to put the 8 king. It wouldn't matter if it's your crib or your opponent's crib. You would hold 5-5, jack, and pitch the 8 king. By the way, we're going to get into discarding your own grip. About half the time, when you're discarding your grip, it's going to be garbage. You're going to look at it, it's going to be a 6 king, an 8 queen, a 10 king, a 9 queen. About half the time, it's going to be garbage. The important thing is to keep a hand with potential. And we'll get into that here in just a little bit. But when you get a chance, look these over. These are actual hands that were held in club. And the first column is the discard the person made. And to their own crib, what it should be. And as they were discarding to the opponent, what it should be. For purposes of demonstration, these were all considered at 60 holes, each player at 60 holes, because there are places on the board that you would not hold the hand the way it's shown here. You might need pegging cards and would throw the scoring cards away. And it could be an end game scenario. So these I'm showing here are where both players were sitting at 60 holes. And the discard shown to your own crib and to the opponent's crib are correct. What I'd like you to do is a little examination here. Not for me. It's got about 20 questions on it. I'd like you to take about 10 minutes. If you need longer than that, you can take it home with you and work on it. I don't need the results. I would kind of like to see how you come out on it, but I don't want a name on the paper. The answers are probably on the back of your sheet. Make your choices and then you might want to double check them. I'd like you not to ask for help other than a deck of cards. If you want to use your deck of cards, go ahead. I really don't expect you to show the results to me. I've got something else in mind. But to get back to the actual substance of the class, I do want to point out a few things here which I see happen very frequently. Number five. It's a very powerful hand. And with the five cut, I'm amazed how many people count it and forget the flush.
Yep.
I know.
I mean, they know they got 16, but they forget the flush. And it's a full 20 points. 16 plus the four in the suit is 20. So watch for that. Another one that happens far more than it should is number eight. And it's particularly true if the deuce is on the deck. It's 12 for some reason if the deuce is on the deck. Most people get it if it's in their hand. But it counts the same way. The two deuces with the one and makes the additional 15. So you got 15-6 plus the double run of eight is 14. Number 10. You know, I often point out that any triple run is worth 15. That's the starting point. It doesn't matter if it's three deuces and a 3-1, or three jacks and a queen king, or three sevens and an 8-6. But after 15, you either need to add the 15s first plus 15, or take 15 and add the 15s. So in this case, we'd have 15 plus 6, or 6 plus 15 is 21. But the triple run itself is worth 15. And I think it's a deuce, deuce, 4, 4, 7. I see it counted wrong most every week. And how you look at it, you got a 4 in the two deuces, you got a 4 in the two deuces, and you got two 4s. That 15-6, and what are we going to live? Two pairs. 6 and 4 is 10. I see 8 points taken for most every week. So, at 10. remember to flush number 15. Number 15 is a nice little diamond flush. 15, 2, 3 is 5, 4 is 9. That's why you kept it, right? Did you know you had 9 before the cut came up? And then the cut is a 10. So the 10 spot adds 2 points. So if you knew you had 9, now you have 11. 16. I see this count, I see this hand coming anywhere from 14 to 24. It's 3 threes with 2 sixes. And you see what happens? It's 2 sixes with a 3, 2 sixes with a 3, 2 sixes with a 3. What are 3 threes? So it's the 9 and 6, 9 and 6. So what are we up to?
18.
And then you add the pair, plus 6, you got 18. 15, 2, 15, 4, 15, 6, 15, 8, 15, 10. 2 is 12 and 6 is 18. And then, I don't know. No. Right, yeah, whatever you want to call it. Is it knobs in your hand and nibs on the deck? Or is it jack of his heels? I don't know, people call a lot of different things. Right jack is okay with me. Anyway, add 1 point for it if it's in your hand. Remember, if it's on the deck and you're dealing, you get 2 for it. Don't try to take 2 for it if your opponent has to deal. You can only slap your finger real quick. Let them take 2 for it, and then you can bitch about that the rest of the game. If it wasn't for that, you would have had a good scorecard. So we're going to get into some exciting stuff about discarding to your own crib. Hopefully I got my papers in the same order you have. These 2 little exercises here. I would like you to, Dave, the first 3 sheets there, would you? No, on the bottom row. And let me have the first one and then take those other 2.
Was in there. Oh, I did it.
Okay. You should all have a paper that says discarding tips number 6. One of the reasons we teach discarding to own grip first is because I've observed that most people are quite weak on doing that. They seem to have a pretty good idea of how to screw up their opponent's grip, but they don't seem to have too good of an idea on how they might put building blocks in their own. And part of the problem is they don't recognize building blocks. We're going to show what they are. And of course, I would think that you, if you have the choice, would like to have a good counting grip. It's a big factor. Big factor if you can put something in your grip. If you're relying on your opponent to put something in your grip, you might wait a long time to count more than four. And you're going to count a whole bunch of twos. So, how do I load my grip? Well, there's a couple of basic premises that are important. We've got to play probabilities. Mathematical probability. The deck of cards is what it is. Can't change the composition of the deck. It's what it is. If it's correct, you've got 52 cards, and there's four cards of each 13 denominations. And if you multiply 4 times 13, you get 52. Well, avoid hunches. Good cribbage players gave up on hunches years ago. You could still do that at blackjack, I guess. Anybody here play blackjack?
Yeah.
How about Texas Hold'em? But they play Texas Hold'em? And you don't even, I mean, they use the term them, hold them. What do you got, two cards? I mean, cribbage, you're down to six. Last week is to understand that that deck is comprised of nickels and dimes. You got a 1-4 5-point couplet, you got a 2-3 5-point couplet, the 4-5s, 4, all of these dimes now, tens, jacks, queens, kings, times 4, 4 times 4 is 16. There's 16 of them suckers and dime. 4 nickel. 2-3, that's 8 cards. 1-4, that's 8 cards. 8, 16, 20, 36. 70% of the deck. Nickels and dimes. Might be able to see as we move through these classes how that has application. 70% are nickels and dimes. Of course, when you look at your cards, you're thinking whose grip it is, and tonight we're talking about exclusively it's your grip. It's your grip. You're going to be making discards to your own grip. Next week, we're going to talk about what to do to your opponent. Where are you on the board? And where do you need to be? We're going to have two classes later. I can't start with them, I'm sorry. The whole game is based on position, but we can't start there. We'll get there. But most people who don't even understand the theory of 26, or critical position zones, which is a concept I developed many years ago, have some understanding if their position on the board is good or bad. You need to discard in relation to that. When you're discarding to your own crib, if you like where you are, you might play a little stronger hand and not worry about the crib. But if you've got kind of a weak hand you're looking at, your position is okay, but it might not be if you only get 4 points out of this hand and two in the crib. Then you might want to look at something to drop in the crib that might up the ante a bit, up the crib score. But it all comes back to where you are on the board. So how can you load your grip? What are the best discards you can make to your own grip? Now you have on the back of that page there, this one is called Discarding Tips Number 6, second page, there front and back. You will find a group of discards with average 6 points or more to your own grip. Everybody see that? There's a square there. A group of 10 discards and average 6 points or more to your own grip. How do I know that they average 6 points or more?
Because for 40 years you've been writing it down.
You did the math.
Actually, I recorded 250,000 grips over a long period of time. And in fact, it was done before computers. So I had stacks of tablets full of these numbers. When computers came into being, I put them on spreadsheets. But people who knew me in the early days, I would ask them, do you mind if I write some notes down while we're playing? And some of them said, no, by God, not while we're playing. Do it somewhere else, but not here. If you decide to take notes and play, ask the person if it bothers them. If it does, wait till the next one. It's important not to disrupt somebody's frame of mind or something because you're writing down stuff. So, but anyway, the 5-5 is at the top of the list. And when you're dealing, you're going to have a lot of chances, and I'm going to show you some of them. You're going to have a lot of chances to put a pair of fives to your grip if you forget about those double runs. Because the 5-5 fits with a lot of cards. And I'll show you a couple of tricks about that. One's called the big hand move. And if you can apply that to your game, you'll find that about half the time, you can put a strong discard to your grip. 5-5 averages almost 9 points to your grip. So if you're dealing and you've got a 5-5 in your hand and it's only worth 2 points in your hand, you might think real seriously. For instance, could you have 3, 4, 5, 5, 8. Is that 6 cards? To keep the double run, what are you going to do? Put an 8-4 or 8-3. Start with a 6 and put a pair of 5 in the crib. It's available quite often. I'll show you some other examples. Deuce three, wow. Some people say that's my favorite discard.
That's right.
It gets a lot of grips, 10 or more, doesn't it? Because folks will take a chance on throwing you 2 10-point cards when they won't throw you 2 small cards or 2 middle cards. So if you've got a deuce three on the table, it not only works with those king three, king deuce, queen one, king one. It not only works with those, it works with all those 10-pointers. So not as strong as a pair of fives, but it's right there in a good solid second. 7.169. You remember from last week we talked about the key connectors. The jack among the 10-point cards is the key connector. The jack is a card that your opponent won't give you. Your opponent will play the jack with a 6, 7, 8. Your opponent will play the jack with a 1, 2, 3. Your opponent will play the jack with any number of other combinations. So when you put the jack to your grip, you increase the likelihood that you will have a good score in crib. What does it do with a king, queen, discard? What does it do with a 10 queen discard? So it connects them. And even without the cut, very often there's nine. If you've got a face card, how many times do you do that and you get a face card cut and you figure you've got 16 or 17 in the crib and you turn it over and you got 16 or 17 in the crib? It works that way. Because that's a very key building block. Five jack, very key. One of the discards is not understood so well. You notice 5-6 drops in there next? 5-6 has a higher average than a 5-king. Before the night's over, I'll give you a paper that shows why that might be. And if you think about it, king 4, queen 4, 10 4. Without any help from the cut, you've already got 2, 4, and 3, or 7, without any help from the cut. Any 10-pointer gives you 9, 4, 5, or 6 gives you a what? So, 5-king, the 5-king is better than the 5-queen. 5-queen is the lowest scoring of those 5-10-point combinations. The reason being that the most frequent discard that you will get among the face cards is the king. And very often with the 10. If you think how often you're able to pitch a 10 king to your opponent's grip, very high percentage. So the king 10 do better than the 5 queen. Oh, they're all good discards. Don't steer away from a 5 queen if that's what you got. But understand that the 5-king is better, and the 5-10 is better, and the 5-queen is not quite as good. 4-5, and you'll have a paper that compares the 4-5 with the 7-8. A lot of folks have fallen in love with the 7-8. So the 4-5 has a higher average than the 7-8 to your own grip. Why might that be?
Nickels and dimes.
Did you want to throw a clean six? A face card and a what?
Six.
Yeah! I run into people every week who say, my favorite discard is a 6-king, a 6-queen, a 6-10. Anytime. That's my favorite discard. Well, if you've got a spare 4 and 5, you can make some real nice cribs out of their favorite discard. And they're going to say, king, 6? For 14? Oh, give me a break. Then you notice the 7-8 shows up there just a little off that 4-5. And then, besides the 5s, the only pair that makes the top 10 is a pair of 3s. The 5s and the 3s are the only two pairs that are in the top 10. We'll talk some about whether pairs are good or cards of sequence are better. I got a paper on that before we get through, hopefully tonight, but we might not make it all the way tonight. Is everybody okay right now? And we can take a short break in about 15 minutes? Okay, I think I can last 15 minutes. I have a bladder and I figured out the capacity by minutes, and it's 36. 36 minutes capacity.
So,
oh, I'm blue. I think standing is my best position for some reason.
We haven't done the math.
Now, you notice now there's another group. These aren't bad discards. The next 10 down are all discards that average better than 5.5 and less than 6. And notice right up there, the fact that the 5-7 and the 3-5 are both ahead of 7-7. Look at the averages. The 5-7, the 3, 5, and a 7, 7. A 5 with anything averages very close to 6 points. Doesn't matter if it's a 1-5 or the 5-9. Those are the two lower scoring ones. It's still right at the door of 6 points. So don't be fearful when you can put a 5 in your crib, regardless of what goes with it. And then you'll see right after this pair of sevens comes a pair of deuces, and then a pair of sixes, and then a deuce 5, a 5-8, a 1-4, a 1-1, and an 8-8. Do you know how many 2-point cribs an 8-8 scores on your side of the board? Don't be lulled into throwing a pair of 8s on the other side. The most frequent discard made by the dealer of the 91 discards possible is a 7-8. So when you say, well, and you're buying a pair of 8s, hell, I don't get nothing out of the damn thing. Hold on to your chair. And by the way, not just 7-8, 7-7, 6-7. If you look at the 10 most frequent discards the dealer makes to his own crib, 4 of the 10 are middle card combinations. 4 of the 10 are small card combinations. But we're going to do that next week. So tonight we're focusing on, and notice the final group starts with a 5-9. Sorry, I misread up above. That was a 4-4 pair. Notice there's 3 pairs in a row to end that group, 4-4, 1-1, and 8-8. And then the final group are all more than 5. Well, not quite. Close to 5 and up to 5.429. 5-9, 1-4, 8-5, jack-jack, 9-9, 6-7, 3-4, 6-9, queen-queen, jack-queen. I do want to mention, notice in this little box here that a 6-7 and a 3-4 are right together. And they look better than they are. Why is it that a 6-7 and a 3-4 don't score so well to your own crib?
Your opponent doesn't throw fives.
You might go all night and nobody will throw you a 5. But play 9 games of crib, you can never find a 5 that your opponent puts in your crib. So they're dead on one end. The 6-7 works if there's a deuce in there, and the 3-4 works if there's a deuce in there, or the 6-7 works if there's a king and an 8, or a queen and an 8. But the 6-7 and 3-4 are dead on one end. If you want them to work with a 5, you've got to turn the 5 on the deck, because you can play a long time and never find a 5 in your crib from your opponent. Really, really important to remember. Yeah. Two, you put in your crisp. Real important. It's the only thing you need to remember. I mean, the other four are in front of you, and the starter card is on the deck. So. Questions?
Very often your pair of eights will be worth two. But you can't
That's what it calls for. If you got a hand, I mean, it's a jack, jack, queen, king, and an 8-8. I don't think anybody's going to think what the 8-8 is worth in the grip. You've got to hold the hand. Nothing you can do about that. Pair of eights is a pretty weak pair, but it's going to get you 2 points a lot of time. And 2 points is better than none. So a 6-8 won't get you 2 points every time. An 8-8 will. So I think it's time for a short break. Make it about 8 minutes.